Okay, hello everyone. It's Friday, April 16th, day 32 of our classes. And as you may see, 2 weeks left, right? If not counting today, 2 weeks left before the end of the class. So I recall you will have your third midterm exam on Monday, again in Zoom like usually. Please turn on your cameras, be ready. Exam will be based on chapter 6 and the piece of chapter 7 events so far, that is until subsection 7.9, until TDS relations and S naught values. After which we will have 5 more lectures and it will be quite compact. Because we want to go through many things, and there will be one more homework, which is presumably be due last day of the class, April 30th. Yeah, so what I want to do today, I still want to talk a little bit about S naught values to give you hints about the homework. And yes, I recall, for those who read my emails and attend my lectures, there is a bonus. I do extend homework until tonight, say 6 a.m. tomorrow morning, okay? But it does not mean that you should work overnight. It means that you have today to complete everything unless you finish, because I want you really to take it seriously. But tomorrow morning I will post the solution because you need it for your exam, right? So yes, 6 a.m. tomorrow morning, okay? That we extend. Again, exam 3 may be still game changer for you. So please don't deteriorate it much. Take it seriously and learn everything. Don't do silly mistakes. Please realize it. Another point again, please evaluate this course if not yet before the ACIs are closed, because still I have little response rate. Please evaluate it when you have chance. And what I want to do now, again, I want to talk a little bit in more detail about last topic, and I want to give you some help for the exam. Yeah, and remember, today at 5 o'clock, it will be my help session, instructor help session for the exam. We will see, it depends on quorum, how it goes. I don't think I need to go through the slides and teach something, but I think I should answer your questions and give you and talk mostly about typical mistakes that you do. Okay, so what we did last time, let me recall. Okay, let me share my screen eventually and let me recall what happened. So we talk about, and now I believe you know entropy, but last time we start with what we call TDS relations, right? And these TDS relations allowed you, to calculate entropy based on some tabulated values, which you may or may not know. So here, what we did, right? Here are TDS relations that you see on your screen, right? One relation couples entropy with du, second relation couples with dh. And provided that you know that what is du, it's cv dt, and what is dh, it's cp dt, we actually managed to express it like this. So what we realized last time. So again, as always, we consider what? We consider two limits, and please don't confuse it. We consider solids and liquids. And for solids and liquids, what do we have? For solids and liquids, this term, dv term, does not exist. Because what is solids and liquids? They are already compressed. So they are not compressed anymore. Their volume will not change, right? But so that will be your expression. And what we get, that is the formula. That generally speaking, entropy change, specific entropy change, can be calculated as this integral. So it's function of temperature only. And if you, well, how to get this? Strictly speaking, you should integrate, but very often for solids and liquids, specific heat does not depend on temperature much. So you'll really approximate it like this. It gives you the following logarithmic dependence. And what I told you about logarithm, that definitely the more entropic your system has, the higher the temperature, the more entropic it is. But logarithmic dependence is weak, right? So if temperature increases 1,000 times, your entropy may increase maybe just order of magnitude. So please remember this. Now, what is serious and what is even more important? that what is serious, what is more important. Yeah, like some people comment in the notes. Yeah, in fact, I sent emails. Those who don't attend my lectures or those who don't read my emails, they will have to do homework still by noon today. Otherwise, how they will know it if they don't read my emails and don't attend? That's bonus for you. Okay, anyway, so let's continue. So ideal gases is different. Why it's different? Because they occupy the entire volume, they are fully compressible actually, right? So here we have another term you should care about. Remember, you have this formula, you have this formula, but key point that you don't neglect these terms. So this is, last time we considered two expressions. This was expressions through CV, this is expression through CP. And remember which one we prefer? We prefer a second one. Why? Because it is pressure that people prefer to measure. So that is what you have. So what this formula gives you that you see on your screen? In this formula, we manage to what? We manage to split two terms. We manage to split entropy change in temperature term, right? Maybe in temperature term here, and in pressure term. Correct. And that expresses important things. Remember, I told you example, what happened if I heat the room and what happened if I pressurize the room. When you heat system, you make it more disordered, more entropic. And that is what you see here. Definitely the more temperature jumps, the larger the entropy will be. But with pressure, it's vice versa. That's why you have sign minus here, right? You say sign minus. So don't forget about this pressure term. We don't have this term for liquids and solids, but we do have this term for gas. And this term may be dominant. Don't forget about this. Okay. Now, what we did next? What we did after this? What we did after this? After this. So when we talk about liquids and solids. So this we discuss. After this, we say the following. So how to calculate this integral? Yeah, you can approximate, but there is another way. So we introduce the concept of so-called S naught. This is kind of entropy. Why I say kind of entropy? Well, this is not entropy, but it has the same dimension as entropy. And if you have isobaric pressure, it will be entropy. So it's integral from zero to T of this value. Okay. Why we do it like this? Because then any integral from between two temperatures will be nothing like difference between S2 minus S1 naught. Please take a look. Everybody understands this? Everybody remembers definite integral and calculus? You should. Why we do it? Why we did like this? Because we are lucky. Somebody already calculated this integral for you. So they are already in your tables. If you look at your tables, you have these S naught values for any given temperature. So now your S naught is nothing but function of temperature, okay? And then if you want to calculate your entropy change, you just go and take the formula. So what you will have? It will be S naught change and pressure term. And S naughts are already in your tables. Like you see here on the screen, where it is? Yeah, here it is on the scene on the screen. There is a table, correct? Temperatures and S naught. For instance, your table A17. This is table from your tables. So these values are already there. They are calculated. Okay. Does it make sense for you why we do it? But don't confuse pressure term. And now, what you can see from this circle formula? If pressure is constant, if P1 is equal to P2, what does it mean? Then there will be no this term. And S naughts will be real entropies, real specific entropies. But otherwise, the entropy change is not the case. Do you agree? Does it make sense for you? Now, what also? Well, so they're in your tables, correct? For instance, like we discussed, if you go to table A17, for instance. Hey, here they are. For air, here they are. You see temperature, enthalpy, internal energy, specific enthalpy, specific internal energy, and S not specific kind of the entropy associated with temperature. You see this value, so you get a substitute. Well, if you don't have air, but if you have nitrogen or say oxygen or whatever it is, what will happen? Then remember you have bar values. You see my screen, if I increase it, remember what are bar values? Bar values are values per unit, what? Per unit mole. How to get bar values from our typical values? Well, very simple, we discussed it. You just need to multiply or divide by molar weight, depending on what you have. So if you here you have bar values, if you divide this by mass, molar mass. Remember what is molar mass? Mass, and you divide this by molar mass. And if you divide this by molar mass, then you will come to what? S2 minus S1. Correct? That's how they coupled. Does it make sense? So these are the formulas that you need to use on your homework, which is still in progress, at least in 3 problems. Problem number 5, problem number 8, problem number 7. Please make sure you understand how to do it. And please make sure you distinguish closed and open systems there, right? Yeah, another point about your homework. Please look at your equations. Very often you can just write PV is equal to MRT ideal gas law for state 1, state 2, divide 1 by 1. You don't need to express something. It will be really simplified. Use temperature always in Kelvin. It will be really simple from the very beginning. That helps you. And I recall, remember, there is difference between work and boundary work. In 3 problems of your homework, you have rigid tank. So there will be no boundary work, but still there will be work generated by electric heater, by styring and so on. So how you get it? Write down balanced equation and get it from there. Okay, so what we see here? And let's do some examples as well. So how to use this values and why we use it? And by the way, in addition to S naught, people may introduce another couple of quantities. So what is S naught? Unit of S naught is the same as entropy, so it's the same like specific gas constant. So may introduce another parameter, which will be like this. I will scale the S naught by R, take its exponent, and I will call this PR, okay? And this will be relative volume. This value will be, we call it relative pressure. And you can calculate relative volume like inverse relative pressure. Why we do it like this? I will tell you. Because in your tables, please see, in your tables here, for air, for instance, in particular, you do have relative pressure and relative volumes as well. Here it is. So they're already placed here as functions of temperature, so you calculate. And please realize, S naught is the same like relative pressure. You introduce one function, you can take another invent another function, right? Nobody prevents you to do it. Okay? Now, why like this? I will tell you. So let's say I have isentropic process. You all remember now what is isentropic. Correct? Isentropic, if you have something staying reversible, say internally reversible and insulated and adiabatic, it means isentropic. So what will happen with my equation here if it's isentropic? If it's isentropic, that left-hand side is zero. So what I will have? I simply have here, look, I will have that this is zero, okay? And if it's zero, what I have here? Here is my equation. Do you see? May and then from this equation, can I express pressure term? What I will have? I will have that logarithm P2 over P1, right? It's nothing but what? But S naught divided by R, it will be S2 naught minus S one naught divided by R. Then if I express, you see downstairs here, if I express pressure, so what will have that for isentropic process? Again, we talk about isentropic, okay? For isentropic process, that one, then pressure ratio will be this one, exponent of S2 naught minus S1 naught. And what is this exponent? I can express it like ratio of exponents. Everybody remembers how to deal with exponent with calculus? And this will be nothing but ratio of relative pressures. So you see what is nice? For isentropic process, isentropic, not isobaric. Let's say you have isentropic process, compression or expansion. So for this process, pressure ratio, it's nothing but ratio of your relative pressures. And you can easily derive that ratio of specific volumes will be again like this. Okay? Nice? Which will give you temperature ratio from here and so on. It will be ratio of specific volumes that you may calculate. And these values, relative values, they're already in your tables. You see how nice? Okay. Not nice yet, yeah? Okay? Then let's do example. I just put it instead of open text, I just put it a part of your slides. So let's say I have here is isentropic compression of air. So it's like what happened in real car engine, but we approximate fuel by air standard cycle. So you have like piston cylinder assembly filled with air. And originally this air at 95 kilopascals and 295 Kelvin. So it's near atmospheric and near room temperature, right? So that's air here. And what happens then? Then, like in real car engine, you compress your substance, right? We'll talk about this, by the way, in more detail when we start talking about Otto and diesel cycles. It will be last week of the classes. But now just realize air is compressed. It's compressed 8 times. So after compression, your volume will be 8 times smaller. Okay? And it stated that it's isentropic compression. It means it's adiabatic and internally reversible. Adiabatic, not isothermal. Definitely temperature will rise, like if it happens in the cavern where it's very hot. So you compress it 8 times. And the question, what will be temperature at the end? So what should we do? I have state one. So here is my T1. My temperature is 295 Kelvin. So what I can do? I can write down many equations, but I will use tables and I remember the nice ratio. What is now a nice ratio? You just discussed that if you have isentropic expansion, then what? Then ratio of your relative pressures and relative volumes will be equal to your pressure and volumes. I know that my volume drop 8 times, which will mean that my relative volume will also drop 8 times. Is it nice? So what should I do here? Let's see. I will go to see, okay, my temperature is 295 Kelvin. So I will go to my table. And then I see, okay, where is, this is air standard cycle. So table A17, please go. And this is actually, by the way, example from your textbook, so you can follow it then. So let's go here. I have my temperature 295 Kelvin. Where it is? Here it is, right? Here it is. So at 295 Kelvin, what do I have? What is my volume? 295 Kelvin is here. What is my relative volume? Here it is. No problem with units, it's scaled value. You don't need units here. You need just this value. So 647.9, 648 values, okay? So this is my relative volume at initial state. Now, I compressed it. So what does it mean that I compressed it? It means, what it means? It means that your new specific relative volume will be 8 times smaller than what we have. So I can write here, it will be what? It will be me. R1 over V R2, okay? And what is my VR1? We just found it, it will be 648, something like this, 647.9, yes? I found it, right? So if I know this, will I find new specific volume? New relative volume, I'm sorry, new relative volume, yes? Here it is. You just divide it by 8 and you will end up with something like 81, right? And then I will see what temperature corresponds to such a relative volume. I will go back to my table and see. Okay. I will see. So here you see relative volume drops with temperature, as it should be. So it should be 81, something like this. So what will happen? It will happen that I'm in between these two points, 660 and 670. So my temperature will be in between them. I will interpolate between these two values. And I will get a correct answer where it is. Correct? Here it is. So, and temperature will be 663 Kelvin, something like this. High, definitely higher temperatures because it's isentropic, it's not isothermal. Please, at help session, I realized how many people confuse adiabatic and isothermal and isentropic and isothermal. Fully different items. Okay, that's what we calculated. So does it make sense how to use tables? I hope so. Well, I recall, generally speaking, so this is your formula, right? So generally speaking, you have logarithm for pressure term, but for CP term, you have this integral and you use S naught values to calculate it. Well, if you don't want to use S naught values, potentially you can also approximate it like this. But this is a simplification because you are expected to use S naught values. If you simplify, however, then what you actually will do? You will reduce temperature dependence. If you do like this, again, you have logarithmic temperature dependence and logarithmic pressure dependence, which is okay. But in reality, temperature dependence is stronger because CP grows with temperature. Does it make sense? Do you know how to use it now? I hope so. Now, if so, then let me give you, I don't know, some introduction to exam or whatever, but I want you to talk about exam. So how to prepare to exam? Again, I don't have time to teach you something, but maybe I can talk about, give you some hints and talk about classical mistakes. So what is your task here? Remember, your task is for this exam very simple. Your task is very simple. Your task is to be flexible with entropy, how to say it. And you may realize that when you, what is bad that you need to absorb a lot of material promptly in this course. That is not my choice, that's what we should do. But what is good that material is self-consistent. And if you're really already good in chapter 6 and 7, you will see that everything is self-consistent. Like if you violate second law, everything is violated, entropy becomes, entropy generation become negative and so on. Otherwise, everything is self-consistent, right? So the more you understand, the easier it becomes. So, sorry, here is, remember I give you topical overview. And basically, when you look at topical overview, make sure that you have something to say, that you know Kelvin, Planck, Clausius, and entropy statements. You know the different and how they look like, right? You know the power cycle, you know, and you know what is heat engine, right? And thermal efficiency. You know refrigeration and heat pump cycle and their coefficient of performance. So generally, remember what I told you at very first lecture. That what we know that ancient Greeks did not, what we do in thermodynamics, we do two things. We transfer heat, we convert heat into work, and that is what power cycle does, right? And heat engines is any device which operate on power cycle. It's not just engine, anything like this. And what we know about it, that it can convert heat into work, but not entirely. Something should be lost. It is Kelvin Planck statement of the second law that you need to have second reservoir. So a heat engine may not have 100% of efficiency. Carnot efficiency is maximal efficiency. Everybody knows this. If not, it's bad. Okay. And another thing that we deal in thermodynamics, it's refrigeration or heat pump cycles. It, what does it do? It transfer heat from cold to hot source. Unlike ancient Greeks, you know that it's possible. Please don't, and that is your Clausius statement. Please don't say in your exam that it's impossible to transfer heat from cold to hot source. You are not Aristotle to say this. Your fridge does it. It's impossible to do it for free. That is second statement. So your fridge, your heat pump should deposit some energy. And the coefficient, remember what's the difference between them, coefficient of performance, why they differ. You should remember it's the same mechanism, but the different goals. We discussed reversible, irreversible process and irreversibilities and the measure of irreversibilities, which is actually entropy rate. And please don't confuse heat engine and heat pump. Fridge cycle and heat pumps a cycle and the power cycle. Please don't confuse concept. Remember Carnot principles and Carnot cycle. Don't, it's the same name, but different things. Please remember that Carnot principles, I told you an analogy, right? That all saint family are happy in the same way. All other families are worse and they're happy, unhappy in their different ways. The same story here. We say that Carnot principle simply says that ideal cycle has maximal efficiency of coefficient of performance for given reservoirs. And all other cycles have worse efficiency. And we needed some cycle to find its maximum. And the simple reversible cycle was Carnot cycle. So don't confuse it. Very often in the exam, I ask you write down Carnot principle and people draw Carnot cycle. Remember, in thermodynamics, there are not too many names. There is name of Carnot, Kelvin, who is also George Thompson, Joule, Planck, maybe that's all. So there is Carnot principle and Carnot cycle, right? There is Clausius inequality, Clausius integral and Clausius statement. Again, don't confuse it. We talk about entropy, right? Entropy generate, remember what is entropy? What is entropy generation, entropy increase principle? Very classical mistake that people can, if you confuse entropy increase principle. So remember, entropy increase principle does not say that entropy grows. It's only universe of fully isolated system which entropy will grow. Entropy may decrease. Entropy may not be destroyed, but it's just generated. So entropy increase principle says that entropy generation is non-negative. Please remember this. And that's also entropy statement of the second law. Remember balance equation, how we wrote it. Again, classical mistakes. Don't confuse closed and open systems, control volumes, right? They have different equations. And don't confuse balance equation for energy and entropy and for mass, of course. They don't compete. They supplement each other. They work together. Again, always distinguish phases. Solids and liquids is one limit. Ideal gas is our opposite limit. We are typically in between them. Don't use ideal gas law if it's not justified, especially for solids and liquids. That's a classical mistake. And also in this exam, most likely we use Kelvin scale, especially when you use entropy, because you try to avoid singularities, correct? So make sure you're flexible with this. Okay, now, so again, when we remember second law, how we introduce it, remember that it's very important, it's that second, I told you a lot of things about this, that second law cannot be proved experimentally, correct? It cannot be, but our universe would not exist if it doesn't work. So it works, and there are various formulations. But this is still secondary after first law. So remember, if you propose that energy is not conserved, second, no reason to deal with second law. It was this problem in homework six, right? Because if energy conservation is broken, then second law can give you everything. It can give you negative efficiency, whatever it is, only after first law. Okay, Kelvin Planck statement. I don't think I should just remember, you need to have second reservoir. Clausius statement we discuss. Heat cannot go for free from cold to hot source, for free, right? You need to power input. Entropy statement, it stated that it's impossible for any system in operating such a manner that entropy is destroyed. And then we discuss for a while what is entropy and entropy generation. Let me skip many things. Thermal efficiency. So what actually happens here? Remember efficiency, coefficient of performance. What is it? Desired over required. I do believe you remember all the formulas you see on the screen, right? I do believe. And I do believe you understand. And I do believe from here you understand that your thermal efficiency is less than 100%. Less than 100%. And I also believe you understand why. And don't say that it's because you have dissipation, friction, heat losses, and so on. Not because of this. Theoretically, you can avoid them. But even Carnot cycle, which is ideal and reversible, has not 100% efficiency because of Kelvin Planck statement, because you have second reservoir, because of second law. That is why, correct? Remember difference between fridge and heat pump. They do work in the same manner. That's how a device look like. Typically you have throttling valve, evaporator, condensator, and you need to have compressor when you deposit work. So deposit some work to transfer heat from cold to hot source. The difference between fridge and heat pump is the following. That in fridge, key point, what is coefficient performance, desired over required? So what do you want from your fridge? You want for in your fridge, you want to take heat out of your freezer or your fridge enclosure and put it into your kitchen. You don't care about your kitchen here, right? You care about this. So it's QL over work input. While when you are in heat pump, it's vice versa. You take heat from the street and put into your house. So then what you require? You don't care about what happened in the street. Then your efficiency QH was this. That's where it lands. That's the only difference. And what you must remember, and I believe you remember what, that gamma coefficient of performance of heat pump is always larger than one. And beta coefficient of performance for fridge may be larger than one, and that is okay, because you don't convert in here. You remember what these devices are. It's like a cart. You have a cart. On this cart, you put heavy loading and move it. Like, remember, small ant can carry the mass which is 20 times more than his or her mass of this insect, right? The key point is this ant should exist. So it's okay if coefficient of performance 5, 10, or 10. But for efficiency, it's not the case because you convert heat into work here. If you generate potentially more work than heat, if it's larger than one, you don't understand basic principle of engineering. Energy cannot be generated from nothing. It's not entropy. That, remember all this, please. I do believe it's you should be flexible with this. If not, you're in trouble and spend weekend properly. Irreversibility. So everything that you face in practice, mixing, friction, inelastic deformation, everything that destroys your system and doesn't allow you to go back are irreversibilities. And entropy generation was measured with these irreversibilities. That's how we arrived to Carnot principles. I told you, but let me recall it. We simply say that all Saint family, all happy families are happy in the same manner, and all unhappy families are unhappy in their own way, and they are worse than happy families. The same story here. If you have two thermal reservoirs, we say that, second principle, let me start with this, that all power cycles, all reversible power cycles operating between the same two reservoirs have the same thermal efficiency, right? And this efficiency should depend on temperatures only, because temperature is only measured. And also we say that all other cycles, power cycles, operating between these reservoirs will be worse. Its efficiency will be less because there are irreversibilities. It's understandable from basic principles, but we derived it, remember, we derived from second law. So that it is. And now what we came after this? We say that, okay, let's give me please one reversible cycle, I will find its efficiency, and then I will know efficiency of other reversible cycles, and I will know that it's maximum, correct? That's what we did. And that is what? That is Carnot efficiency. That is Carnot cycle. That's how we introduce it. So why we introduce it? Because there are many cycles like this, but Carnot is the simplest existing reversible cycle. And we'll talk about other cycles in last week, like Diesel, Otto, Rankine, Brayton, but now you know Carnot cycle. So please, if you wake up overnight, you should remember two isotherms and two adiabats, right? reversible isothermal expansion, reversible adiabatic expansion, reversible isothermal compression, reversible adiabatic compression. This is Carnot cycle, okay? And well, by default, it's since everything is reversible, definitely it can go clockwise and counterclockwise. See here, if it goes clockwise, what typically power cycle does? It takes heat from here, generate work, and something is released down. Why it's released down? Because of second law, because of Carnot-Planck statement. So even Carnot cycle does not have 100% efficiency. You realize it, right? I say trivial things, I want everybody to understand. QL will go down anyway, even for Carnot cycle. But it's reversible, so you can put it backward. And if you put it backward, it's not power cycle anymore, right? It will be refrigeration or heat pump cycle. It will take QL from here, work will be deposited in, and QH will go up. And based on here, you realize that if I take work output over QH in the left, then what? Definitely will be less than one because only portion is converted. But if here I will take QH over work, it will be larger than one. So COP is large. Well, I believe you all remember these formulas and understand thermal efficiency, coefficient of performance for refrigeration and heat pump cycle. And what is important, please understand. If you understand the topic, you will easily get these formulas. They are very simple from scratch. If you draw a picture, understand what is Q in, what is Q out. And that is how you should learn. So if you ask what's coefficient of performance, you should answer in your words what it is. Don't say it's a formula from slide number 15. The answer about slide number 15 is a bad answer. It means that you don't know what it is. You should explain what it is in your words. Right? And so why we introduce this? So now Carnot cycles, reversible cycles provide you maximal theoretical efficiency. So this is maximal efficiency that you have for Carnot cycle, for any power cycle, right? And this is what we get. Do you remember this? So this is your maximal efficiency. And this is your real efficiency and coefficient of performance. The same expression, but instead of Q, you use T. T here in Kelvin, classical mistakes the students do when they put here T in Celsius, temperature may be negative and you may have anything there. Please realize temperature should be in Kelvin. And this allows you really to understand what we have. So how we proceed? Find your efficiency or coefficient of performance. Find Carnot efficiency or coefficient of performance and compare. I believe everybody understand what is written on the right? Yeah, I compare eta, beta, gamma. I don't compare beta or gamma to each other. I compare eta to eta, beta to beta, gamma to gamma max. And that's what we make conclusion. And I think maybe in my slides it was, let me open, it was presented a little bit better in the lecture slide, isn't it? If I open here, yes. Yeah, here it is. Here is a table, right? So what you should do, compare, for this is for power cycle, this is for refrigeration cycle, that is heat pump cycle. So that's what you do. Calculate and then what? Calculate and compare. Compare them, right? Calculate and compare like we did here, right? And then you will see. If your eta, if your efficiency coefficient of performance is less than maximum, what does it mean? It means that it's true. It may happen. It means that you have irreversibilities in your system which destroy the efficiency, destroy the process, destroy the performance, and it doesn't violate second law. Now, if it happens that your efficiency or coefficient of performance equal to maximal, Carnot, reversible, eta or beta or gamma, what does it mean? That's a very good point. It means that theoretically it's possible. It doesn't violate second law. So potentially, yes, somebody at help section asked me a good question. May we eventually generate ideal system, which will be 100% adiabatic. fully insulated without friction, frictionless. The answer is like this. I don't know. But people invent something. People, you know, people can fly, right? Before people cannot. So potentially it's possible. It does not violate second law. If you invent, so potentially reversible cycles may exist. This does not violate second law. So theoretically it's possible. But if your eta or beta or gamma exceeds maximal, then it's impossible. It's violation of second law. It would mean that irreversibilities are destroyed, which may not happen. That's one way how you proceed from chapter 6, right? And from chapter 7, in 6, you can proceed in the same way by means of Clausius integral. Again, don't confuse Carnot principle and Carnot cycle, and don't confuse Clausius statement, Clausius integral, and Clausius inequality. Here is what we have. Here is Clausius integral. Clausius integral is actually nothing but measure of irreversibility. Sometimes somehow it correlates with entropy generation, but key point is over cycle here. That's why we have conventional sign minus. So what is, so you calculate sigma, and the sigma is measure of irreversibility, it's measure of your penalty. So what does it mean that you get sigma is zero? It means that you did not face irreversibilities. It means that you operates, and since you did not measure face irreversibilities, it means that you can go backward. It means that you face, you have internally reversible scenario. It means that your efficiency or coefficient of performance, it is equal to Carnot efficiency, right? And that is theoretically possible. If your sigma is larger than zero, that's what happened in practice. It means that irreversibilities are present within the system. So your system is not ideal. Your cycle is worse than ideal. And that's okay. Finally, if your sigma is negative by some reason, it means what? It means that you went to count penalty and your penalty became positive. It's impossible. It would violate second law, it's impossible. So these two options, there are like these two options, how you can check chapter 6 and chapter 7, how to check if what you call the nature of the process. And the answer you give, is it reversible, or is it possible or impossible, right? After Clausius integral, we talk about Clausius inequality. Remember, we derived it. Key point why I derived it. Why I call it inequality in brackets? Because that is, on the left, you see the general form. The circle integral of dq over t is less than zero. No, it's non-positive. Recall temperature is in Kelvin. Why temperature is in Kelvin? Because it is absolute zero that you cannot attain. Imagine if temperature is negative here. Imagine if t is zero, then you will have singularity. Right? So when you deal with entropy subject, your temperature should be in Kelvin. Now, why I call it inequality? Because if my process is internally reversible, it becomes equality. It becomes zero. And this point showed you and helped you to introduce entropy. So that's how we introduce entropy. Remember, entropy is a function which differential is given like this. And please take a look here. So what do you see? If you look here, you will see that t is in denominator. So it's one more hint why it should be positive, why temperature is in Kelvin scale. Imagine t is zero here. What would happen? If t is zero, entropy ds will be infinite. So your entropy will jump to infinity and you kill your universe. The only way to avoid it is very simple. Then you cannot attain absolute zero. Or otherwise, I can say that if temperature tends to absolute zero, then what? Then entropy by default also goes to absolute zero. That's how we select it. And that is what we call third law of thermodynamics or Nernst theory. So that's how we introduce it. Again, I don't want to waste much time about entropy, but that is your task. That was your task in this chapter, chapter 7, to deal with entropy. Remember, like four approach to entropy. Entropy is a measure of order or disorder. Entropy is an item from your table. There are formulas for entropy that we discussed in the beginning of the class, so I will not repeat it today. And also remember, like I said, what is second law? Second law tells you what penalty you should pay against nature when you transfer heat from cold to hot source or when you convert heat into work. Nature does not want this, but you pay penalty. And currency in which you pay this penalty, we call entropy, or let's say entropy generation. Recall again, entropy increase principle It's not like entropy cannot decrease. It may. It is entropy generation which cannot decrease. Entropy can be already generated. So the statement that entropy generation is larger or equal to zero, it's second law of thermodynamics. It's entropy statement of second law. So it should be positive or zero. It's impossible to make it negative. But entropy can go down. Example on the left show it. I told you many times this, right? If you put, let's say I have glass of water. When I put my glass of water into a fridge, it will be frozen, its entropy will go down. But when you do this, you can do it. So you can decrease entropy. But when you do it, universe, entropy of the universe will increase because your fridge will generate more entropy in this way. That's what you see here. So you may have isentropic or even reduction in entropy cooling, but entropy will cannot be destroyed. Just example, very like I illustrate, why I call that entropy is a penalty. Like I told you, when you commit any crime, the best way you can do just recognize it and try to pay whatever is possible, recognize that you are guilty and try to pay penalty or whatever it is. Hopefully it's not a big crime. But when you try to hide your crime, all attempts to hide it is also crime and your responsibility will grow. Correct? The same story here. Nature tells you don't decrease entropy. If you want to decrease it, and more entropy will be generated. Like imagine you have a little speeding, you get a penalty ticket. Well, if you don't pay it, if you give a bribe to police officer, if you kill police officer, all this will come to another ticket, suspension of license, and eventually you end up in a jail, right? It means that you will increase crime hiding it. The same story here. Decreasing entropy is like a hiding crime. It's possible, you can do it, but eventually your responsibility will grow and grow and grow. Does it make sense? Does it make sense? Like this year tax due date is extended, but generally speaking, April 15, yesterday is tax due date, right? If you don't fill tax declaration April 15, looks like nothing will happen, right? But eventually you will get penalty to pay, they will catch you. Like here, you don't violate it. Remember, we discussed many things about entropy. What you should remember that in TS diagram, heat transfer is surface area. It's like in PV diagram, work was surface area. Remember it. Work on PV diagram and heat in TS diagram plays the same role. Remember, we talk about entropy balance for a closed and open system. And that's very illustrative. So this formula that you can see here, it states that entropy change for a this is for a closed system. What you see here? That entropy change is equal to entropy transfer plus entropy production. This is very big philosophic formula here. Because what you have from here? Because if you don't have heat transfer, you don't have entropy transfer, right? So if you have adiabatic and internally reversible, right? Adiabatic, insulated, say adiabatic plus internally reversible, plus internally reversible, what does it mean? It means that it will be what? It will be isentropic. Because if this is zero, then this is zero. Isentropic, it's adiabatic and internally reversible, it's isentropic. But not vice versa. I may have isentropic case here when I have this value to be negative and this value to be positive. Okay. So otherwise, for a closed system, I may have isentropic cooling, like I described in the fridge, but I may not have isentropic heat. The bottom line, entropy change may be positive, may be zero, may be negative. Heat transfer to may be negative, may be zero, may be positive, because you may have heating, cooling, or it may be insulated. But entropy generation, it's non-negative. It can be positive or theoretically it can be zero. And this is entropy principle. For open system, right? That's what we say. For open system, here is your equation. And again, what we say here, that entropy change in the system, it's entropy transfer by heat, by mass, plus we have this term here, which we did not have for energy. It's entropy production term. Now, remember, if you don't have mass transfer, if your system is you come back to closed system like it was before. But generally speaking, this term exists and it may dominate. Now, if you have steady system, you don't have this term. If you have adiabatic system, you don't have these terms. If you have internal reversible system, you don't have these terms. But that's what you calculate. And please remember, this term is very hard to calculate. So most likely what you do, calculate all other terms by the formulas, by tables, and then you will get this term as rest. That's how people proceed. Well, I don't talk about TDS relations because you already discussed this today, right? S naught values. So I will stop at this point. It's just 10:52. So I recall, please evaluate this course if you did not yet, because I should close the CIs and so far not many students responded. Please do it. Now, I recall home, you can please complete your homework as I submit this night. Again, I don't expect you to tomorrow to do it this night. You should sleep this weekend properly and work hard this weekend to be prepared to your exam on Monday. So you better complete homework by midnight, then sleep, and then in the morning you start preparing your exam. That's the best way. Please don't stay overnight. Night is only 8 hours. You better sleep nightly and work daily. I don't follow this advice myself, but that's what is healthy. Now, again, I will have my help session today at 5 o'clock. Please come. If you need, again, we will see how the same Zoom link like other help sessions. It will be for exam 3. I may answer your questions and give you some hints. Otherwise, your exam is on Monday. Please be in Zoom. Please take it seriously. It's important, right? And have a nice weekend, but let it be fruitful weekend because I want you to have good exam. Frankly speaking, many of you did bad exam too. So now we should change this game now, believe me. I really want you to write it much better, if possible. Okay? Yeah, I have office hours today, yes. You can join my office hours, okay? Maybe at least for half an hour. Yes, thank you. Okay, if no more comments, questions, I will call, let me stop. I will sharing screen and I will, let me stop sharing screen and I will actually stop recording. Right, and well, see you on Monday, right? Good luck.